Greetings to everyone around the world, and a warm welcome to another edition of Veritas at veritasradio.com. I'm your host, Mel Fabregas, and I sincerely thank you for joining me once again. And if this is your first time, please make yourself at home. To listen to tonight's full interview, you know what to do. Simply go to our website, veritasradio.com, if you're not already there, and click on the subscribe button. Expand your horizons and give yourself the gift of truth. And for pure organic sulfur crystals, MMS, or our futuristic metal-cased USB drives with all our seasons and bonus material, go to the Veritas store. And by popular demand, tonight's special guest is best-selling author and investigative journalist, former law enforcement officer, and senior executive in the technology sector, David Paulides. We'll discuss more mysterious disappearances in national parks and his new book, Missing 411, The Devil's in the Detail. And to learn more about David Paulides and purchase all his books, visit his website at canammissing.com, which is also linked at ours. And directly from Colorado, I'd like to welcome David Paulides. Hello, David, and welcome back to Veritas.
Hey, thanks, Mel. I appreciate it. It's always a good time spending some interesting time talking to you about the cases.
Absolutely. And usually I would introduce and talk about how you started in all of this, but we accomplished that already, and anyone can listen to our first interview on our website. I want to leverage these 2 hours as much as we can without being repetitive. And as you say in the new book, we're not going to delve deeply into details to prep the listeners for an understanding of the issue. To the listeners, please stop the audio right now and listen to the first interview if you have not done so before. That way you'll be able to have a clear understanding of what we'll be discussing tonight. But first, David, the new book about the title, The Devil's in the Detail. Why the title?
Well, first of all, detail is an important part when you're doing research. And there's that old saying, the devil is in the detail, and it's true. And the stories are nice, and the dates are nice, but really you need to get down into the nitty-gritty, get down into the dirt, and start really figuring out what is the commonality between each of these. The other part of that is that in earlier books, there have been an abnormal amount of people that have disappeared in areas where the name Devil appears in the geographical location. Devil's Lookout, Devil's Mountain, Devil Lakes. It just seems like an abnormal amount and too many coincidences to just ignore it.
Absolutely. And, you know, I wonder, how many times have you been denied information? We see this all the time in your cases. How many times have you been denied information about a certain case and you're told you'll never get information about this case? What is the reason they give you, if any? And have you appealed or sought a judicial review after, you know, requesting a FOIA request?
Well, the outright and the straight-up denial has happened just once, and that was on the Stacey Ayres case out of Yosemite. And that was verbally told to me on the phone with a National Park Service special agent. And no, they never gave a specific reason why I would get it, why I wouldn't get it, other than I just wasn't going to get it. And their other denials are more contrived, and either they make the dollar amount to get the report so exorbitant that nobody could afford it, and say $1.4 million for a list of missing people from their entire system, or more recently, $7,100 for them to review a file on a case that where Ranger disappeared. So they put roadblocks in front of you, and I suppose you could call that their way of denying it.
Do you think that this happens just to you because your name is probably very public out there?
You know, I'd like to say I hope not, but I have a gut feeling that this is more organized than we may think. And there have been other people, in fact, other National Park Service rangers that have FOIA'd the National Park Service over details and have run into roadblocks before as well. So to say that this is a first for the National Park Service, I would definitely say not. It seems that they have a long history of not being as transparent as they would like the public to think. And in reality, their interpretation of the Freedom of Information Act is quite different than many other departments in our government.
And the word missing and presumed dead, this is something that the Department of Interior uses a lot. How can people find those who are lost if they're removed or purged from a database on a case that should not be purged?
Well, that seems to be a pretty convenient way to wash your hands of many missing persons cases and sweep it away and say, well, the person's presumed dead, they're not really missing anymore. And that's their way to permanently get rid of the case. They won't be found on any databases. They won't be classified as missing people. And if I did come up with the $1.4 million for the list of missing people in the National Park Service, I have no doubt that those cases would not appear because they're no longer missing. They're under this new classification, missing presumed dead. And with that, it's a very, very convenient way to keep the numbers down, keep the public unaware of how many people are missing. And it's unfortunate because when I first found it, I couldn't believe it existed.
Heaven forbid you or I or anyone listening loses a loved one. How do you think they'll feel if their loved one is considered presumed dead without any proof? Actually, I wouldn't have a problem as long as the name is on the list so we can continue searching.
Well, I think anybody would be astounded that the National Park Service would do something like that, and that it may be a policy in the Department of the Interior that may be more widespread than we understand. And there's a very, very good chance that some of the cases that I've found just through digging through newspaper archives, et cetera, may never have been found and may never be understood if we haven't brought them out to light. And with that, I'll transcend to something else, Mel. It's something called NAMIS. And NAMIS is an organization that was founded within the National Institute of Justice, and it was just for this type of thing. And we were contacted by a NAMIS researcher maybe a year ago, and she had read one of the books, and she said, Dave, I think you have cases that need to go on the NAMIS website. And what NAMIS is it's a website specifically used by law enforcement, coroners, forensic people that come up with bones in the woods, just like they would find in the national parks where there's no longer any reports, and they can match reports to the bones and get closure for a family. Turns out that there's, I think, 8 or 10 cases now that NAMIS has from us that they never had before, because we were able to get the original police reports and things to substantiate the case, put it on NAMIS's website, and now if those bodies are ever found, they may be able to link the DNA between the two individuals or the case report and the individual. Without NAMIS, there probably wouldn't be any way to do it other than mere guesswork.
No, if the National Park Service classifies the missing as missing and presumed dead, then what happens when the coroner and medical examiners receive recovered remains? Can they place the bones with the body?
Well, when they explain that there's rooms in coroner's offices in Oregon and Washington that are filled with unknown bones that they've found in the woods, and they can't match them to any bodies. So therein lies the problem with the National Park Service and the Department of the Interior's policy. And like I said, it may be an absolutely contrived and organized policy in order to keep the numbers down so people truly don't know how many people are missing.
You know, I think we discussed this in our last interview, but I'm not a trained investigator like you are, but logic tells me that they're just sweeping the names under the rug to avoid panic. Imagine if you go to XYZ Park and find out there are hundreds of people missing. Would you go in there? They just don't want the public to be aware of the dangers that exist in the woods, as they may, you know, it can affect tourism and how many millions of dollars can be lost.
Well, it could be mind-boggling.
So do you think this is the main reason why they want to keep this under the rug, to avoid people from saying, you know, family, let's don't go to this park this year because this may happen to us?
I've already had people write to me and tell me that I've put them on notice, and you know, the books have made them more aware of these issues. But the reality of it is that I don't discourage anybody from going to our parks. I tell them to go to the parks and carry a transponder, keep your children inside at all times, don't get separated, and don't hike alone. And I think under those parameters, you're generally going to be fairly safe. But it does seem that there's an abnormal amount of missing people in national parks.
You know, reading your books, I find so many similarities between the cases. And I find it interesting that law enforcement, it's not that they're not doing a good job, but they haven't broken the quote-unquote code of these cases, since there's a repetitive nature of the elements that exist on these disappearances. Do you find that peculiar?
Well, you got to remember, Mel, that law enforcement works in a confined area. Say you have a county sheriff. Well, he's responsible for his county. And let's say you have a state police officer. Well, they're responsible for their state. But there's nobody really that's looking at the gravity of the problem when you look at, say, the United States and Canada, and then you start to look at North America as a whole, and then you start to put together the cases jurisdiction by jurisdiction. Unfortunately, missing people is the bastard child of law enforcement. And I've never known an investigator that's wanted to work missing persons cases. And the reason being is that missing people, many of them disappear on their own. They don't want to be around, and there's no crime to that. But when you spend, say, 100 hours tracking down a missing person, and then you find them, and it's just somebody who wants, and then you have people that, say, a teenager that just runs away because he doesn't want to be, or she doesn't want to be with her parents. Well, that's still a missing person and somebody you got to track down. So you get these kind of cases that to some law enforcement people may seem meaningless and a waste of time. But then you run into an issue like this, or say a string of homicides on the Highway of Tears where there's hundreds of missing people, missing women, up in the Canada and British Columbia area. You start to get into something like that, and it starts to get much more interesting quickly. So it's a national or continent issue here, and then it's an issue in other countries. And then you start to think of it, and just like you said, once you read the books and you start to understand the underlying current to the issue and the parallel issues that exist in amongst the different cases, you start to find out that, well, this is a much more intriguing thing than we began with. And I'm not taking credit in luck than anything else, but I wouldn't expect law enforcement to be able to understand this problem and figure it out. And this was somebody who had a team of people with an exorbitant amount of time to really dig deep. And there just aren't those people out there working missing people doing that.
Dave, is the same criterion used, for example, somebody at home doesn't see a relative, you know, get back home tonight? Police usually tells you have to wait 24 hours before you can report the person missing. Is that the same criterion used when somebody gets lost in a national park, or is it a different set of criteria used?
You know, the criteria for reporting missing people has changed a lot over the years. Before, it used to be 24 hours. Now it's changed, and most of the time, law enforcement jumps on it right away. When somebody goes missing in the woods, it's usually a critical issue very, very fast because of weather conditions, because maybe they're hurt, maybe they're lost, maybe they need... It could be a lot different than somebody who's missing in an urban environment, but then again, both cases could need attention immediately. So I don't think when somebody's reported missing, especially a very young person in an urban environment, it's not delayed, it's handled, it's worked on right away. Just like anybody who goes missing in the woods, there's a reaction to it and people are on it quickly.
And I know you don't like to give your opinion, and I won't ask for your opinion, but after so many years of investigating, do you think that the field of suspects is narrowing?
Well, I've had a lot of response to the new book that's out, and I think the surprising aspect that people find is that there's more parameters that are added in this new book than there were in other books. There's a group of people who went missing on the ocean off the coast of Florida. There's a parallel between people we've reported missing and missing airplanes. Somebody in Finland did a phenomenal amount of work and gave us a report indicating that there were 125 planes in 68 years that have disappeared in the Bermuda Triangle.
Yeah.
And four of those incidents match dates of people who have disappeared that we've written about. And if you look at those statistics, the statistical probability that those would match at four different levels is pretty phenomenal.
What do you think the correlation is between these planes disappearing and the people disappearing? Is there a weather phenomenon taking place at the same time?
Yes, there is. And that's part of that profile. But even taking it one step further, we revealed in this book that there's also five aircraft that have crashed while looking for people missing that we've profiled. So now you have four planes missing in the Bermuda Triangle that match the dates of four people who have crashed while looking for missing people. So you could almost say there's some kind of unusual aerial phenomena in conjunction with the missing people, in conjunction with the weather phenomena we've identified with the missing people. So aerial, weather, planes, I don't know what to say about it, but there seems to be a current of commonality there.
I remember growing up in the 70s, one of the corners of the Bermuda Triangle in the Caribbean, and this is what started me in the paranormal road, if you will, was the fact that almost on a monthly basis, I would see the newspaper of, you know, planes or ships, you know, getting lost, almost like the latest Malaysian airline, you know, flight. I think that's a different story. But we don't see that anymore. Yet we continue seeing missing people all over the world, even from the 1800s, sharing the same way in which they were lost. Do you still see the same patterns from 100 or 200 years ago still happening today?
You know, it hasn't changed. It's consistent with that profile, going all the way back to a case in 1756 that we identified. So the real question comes back is, if there was a way to go back into time 500 years ago, was it happening then at the same consistency with the same profile? Maybe. But the real interesting part to us is that that profile has stayed pretty consistent amongst the four books without having to really tweak it. It's the same, like you identified earlier, there is that commonality amongst these cases that is troublesome.
When you have spoken to the National Park Service and the Department of Interior about their method of dealing with missing people, how in good conscience could they not track missing people? What have they told you when you asked that question?
So I've only talked to the head of the law enforcement group for the National Park Service one time about the Stacey Ayres case and why they wouldn't supply it. And then we got into a more deep discussion about why I wanted the information and why I wanted to know so much about missing people inside their system. So they really don't and won't talk too much. I suppose the most revealing thing happened when I was at a national park this last summer with a friend, and we happened to stumble into a informal meeting amongst four older gentlemen in a satellite office of a national park, and I kind of stood there listening to what they were saying, and I knew these guys knew a lot about what was happening. So one of the gentlemen got out and walked to the parking lot, and I followed him out, and I introduced myself, and I said I was a retired law enforcement man, and I said I could tell you were somehow related to law enforcement here, and he said, yes, I'm a retired special agent from the National Park Service. And I thought, bingo, this is exactly what I want to talk to right here. We ended up talking for a long time, and I wanted to understand why the Park Service doesn't track missing people, because it's not only politically incorrect, it's incorrect at every law enforcement level you can imagine. And he said, quoting him, Dave, it's a lack of integrity. And he says, the Park Service does things that don't make any sense, that doesn't have a lot of integrity to it. Everybody else knows they should be doing it, but they won't. And we had a discussion about many things that day. And it was confusing to say the least, disturbing to say the most.
do you really lend credence to the lack of integrity excuse, or is there more an underlying current that's silenced, that it's implied to really don't go there because your job is on the line, and the job of so many people in towns and businesses, local economies could just be devastated if this information came out. I can see this is immoral to even think about it, in my opinion, but you have to look at the other side. If they're protecting their turf, bringing this information out, even though there's people who are missing, would be devastating to them. So I'm trying to just not play devil's advocate here.
I think both ways, Mel, there is a lack of integrity there. Either way you look at it, it is. And I think that, as we've talked about before, where we've offered to buy them clipboards and a laptop and to kind of force their hand, because in the past they've said that they didn't have the money to do this, and they didn't have the money for a big computer system. Trust me, there is no need for all of this. Clipboards in every office of the national parks. And once a month, when they turn in their monthly reports, which they are required to do, that have any big issues in the parks reported to headquarters, you just send in a 5-line notation about where the person went missing off the clipboard, send it in to National Parks headquarters, and somebody with a $500 laptop could keep track easily of every missing, the circumstances, blah, blah, blah. So when they say that they don't have the money to do it, you know that goes back to a lack of integrity. If they wanted to keep track of it, anybody could keep track of this. And as I've stated before, we have had a female from Microsoft that saw what was happening. She offered to help us. She jumped in. And Sue has worked diligently to put together an extensive database that we will gladly share with the National Park Service that we use to track and identify specific elements in these missing people. Now, I know I'm not keeping an open mind that they're going to contact us, because as you said, I think this is an organized method to control the information and keep the lid on this issue.
I'll even up the ante for a moment. I know you want to buy them the clipboards. I'll buy them a computer. I'll even sponsor one full-time person for that entire year that could be sitting in a cubicle in Washington gathering this information. Do you think they would accept that offer?
Maybe they would from you, but I doubt from me.
That's right. That's right. I find it interesting, Dave, how the disappearances don't occur immediately after at the same location, but something could happen, say, at the Grand Canyon, and then, you know, 2 days later in Yosemite. It doesn't happen in the same location. Have you found that commonality as well?
Well, in fact, we talk about it in the books that there's this a hopscotch effect. One on the East Coast, one on the West Coast, one in the North, one in the South. And it's just enough where if you looked at it, you would say it's almost too organized of a dispersal across the U.S. because you would think that every once in a while, 3 or 4 in a row would hit in one area, but it never happens that way. It would be difficult to identify.
And to me, you know, I'm speculating here. I know you don't like to speculate, but this almost seems as if it's being coordinated from a centralized location, because you don't want to have two people disappear one after the other, because that then the whole country will descend upon that area and bring more suspicion.
Correct. So you had a national park and you had 2 or 3 people disappear over a 10 or 15 year period. That's probably not going to raise too much suspicion because there's a rotation of rangers that go through the national parks. Most of them spend between 5 or 10 years in a park and then they move on. And the same is for the life of a law enforcement officer, say, in a county. Say they spend 20, 25 years and they retire. Well, if you keep that spread out a lot, it's not the same place in the county. It's every, say, 7 to 15 years somebody disappears. It's not going to be that big of a deal. And then you spread it out in North America, it even becomes less apparent that there's this taking or missing people.
You know, another interesting aspect after reading your books, and even the latest, is that the cases have very similar circumstances surrounding them. So if there's anyone out there saying, oh, David, you're just making these stories up, then you wouldn't be doing such a good job. Many similarities between the cases. What do you say about that? So similar.
Well, I think that's the part that makes us so interesting. And it's for anyone who actually reads the books, you're going to quickly understand that there's many elements that are similar. In fact, some of the cases almost look like cookie cutters of each other. In the and it can be young people, middle-aged people, older people, high intellect, very low intellect, very few people in the middle, like me, and it's disturbing.
And I know guns are now allowed in national parks, but the volume of people carrying guns also, correct me if I'm wrong, wouldn't that depend on the state or city around the park? Have you found a correlation between location where guns are predominant versus those that are not? In other words, more disappearances in places where guns are not that prevalent.
You know, I can't say that there's a correlation between where guns are, say, more frequently allowed than not. In California, it's probably one of the tightest gun-controlled states, that yeah. And some states in the eastern U.S. And if you look at the numbers, I mean, in Yosemite, the biggest cluster of missing people in North America, it's huge. But then again, you go to Colorado, where the gun laws are fairly liberal and you can carry a gun almost everywhere. Still, the numbers are huge. So the only thing I've publicly stated that I can say categorically is true is that we don't know anybody who's ever disappeared carrying a gun and a personal locator transponder. We've known them to go missing carrying a gun. I've known people to go missing carrying a transponder. Carrying both, I don't know.
Have you ever spoken to Native Americans about the names of some of these locations? I mean, the title, Devil, that these people have been there before we came along. They must know how and why a location was named. Do you know?
Well, and that's a great question, but you got to remember that these places received their geographical names sometimes 150, 200 years ago. And even you talk to the elders or people who have lived in areas a long time, it baffles them sometimes how it got its name. I was just in an area the other day that had an unusual name, and we were asking some people how they got it, and nobody knew. So I think that's a hard thing to get answers to.
But interesting that the name Devil just comes out. Devil's Vomit. There's one that we're going to discuss later. I believe it was in Idaho. But I don't follow Bigfoot or Sasquatch that much, the topic, or even the stories of large flying animals. But I'm just going to say animals for a moment. Some call them flying dinosaurs, flying reptiles, fill in the blanks. And the reason why I bring this up is because of the many children who disappear without leaving any trail or scent behind and then reappear high in a mountain when it would have probably impossible for the child to make the trek. Keeping an open mind here, Dave, the child being grabbed by a flying animal, would not that be far-fetched after all, would it?
Personally, I've never seen that, and I don't hear many law enforcement people in the park system talking about that. Mm-hmm. And if you look at the kids that have disappeared, some of them are pretty big, and I don't even know if there's any birds of prey out there large enough to carry some of these 3 and 4 year olds away that weigh, you know, 40, 50, 60 pounds, way more than the bird. So I don't know if that's real. And then the point of them disappearing, as the parents say, almost in their presence, or I turned around on, if that was happening, you would think that the child would scream and yell at the minimum. At the maximum, you would think that the parents may hear something behind them, a scuffle or some sound or the bird or the child's making. So this has been brought up before. I just have a difficult time understanding how I could make that work.
And believe me, conventional wisdom says it's impossible. But at the same time, no scent. All of a sudden, the child is, you know, a few thousand feet above. And you know it's impossible for the child to make it up all the way up there, you know, without dying. And it's there. So I'm just trying to step outside the box. And stepping outside the box after hundreds of years of these cases, and you have a lot of them, and I commend you for not speculating or coming to conclusions. I think that's, you know, that's a great thing that you have done so far. But with all these years of these cases, isn't it time to go out of our comfort zone to look for answers?
And I think we're one of those groups that is doing exactly that. We entertain all ideas. I've read more books on a variety of topics than most people would ever read in their lives. And everyone has maybe a fringe topic that they like to read about, but throw that in the garbage and then start reading about things you really aren't interested in to keep that open mind. And that's what we've done. And I don't think in this latest book that delving into a disappearance off the ocean and then a disappearance in the skies would happen unless we had kept that open mind. And as long as that profile stays consistent, I think you're going to continue to see us with that open mind and try to understand how far this parameter really goes, that until we could break this code and figure it out. But no, I'm never one to shut down somebody and say, I don't think this is possible, unless, like you just said, common logic just doesn't come into it. Mm-hmm. But you have to keep it.
Yeah, I'm losing you there. Can you hear me?
I can hear you fine.
Okay, good. All right. Now, the best way for me to understand the nature of all of this and for the listeners is discussing some of the cases. So here's a case. Let's start with the new book. This woman and her husband are skiing. The husband makes it to the bottom, and the wife never does. Tell us more.
It happened in February 19th, 1999, Bear Valley, California, 47-year-old physician.
Catherine Wong, Dr. Catherine Wong. That's right.
And she was from Milpitas, California. And this goes back, this hits on a several notes for us. First of all, this is on that high intellectual end of the intellectual scale. She's a smart, smart lady. Took a day off of work to go skiing with her husband. And it was the last ski run. And they go to the top of the chair and she goes, "Hey, I'm going to go this way. You go that way. I'll meet you at the bottom." Okay. He gets to the bottom. She doesn't show up. He waits. Searchers show up. Now, you got to understand, when you search for somebody in the snow, it's a lot different than searching for them on dry, hard dirt. Because off of the ski run, there's only so many paths you can take. And each one of those paths, as a searcher, it's pretty easy to follow. There aren't a lot of places to go that you won't be followed. So you can imagine that after a day or two, you've exhausted every track that's run off that slope that she went down. And there was a big effort, huge effort. And then eventually the weather turned and searchers had to leave. And it wasn't until June of 99, 4 months later, after several other searches, that they finally found bone fragments and some scattered and some pieces of her personal attire, and that's how they found her. Now, let's think about this. So if she left that ski run, you should be able to follow that. Now, you fly over that with FLIR, forward-looking infrared radar that senses heat, you should be able to find her. You bring in canines, you should be able to find her. Now, an interesting note is the sheriff said, well, maybe she was attacked by a bear or a coyote. Okay, well, it's February, there's 20 feet of snow. I don't think bears are running around. They're hibernating.
That's right.
Yeah. And then coyotes, if she was attacked, I think searchers would have found her. In fact, I'm positive they would have. So, because there would have been a big scene. If she was attacked by a coyote on a ski slope, that would have been the first I've ever heard in my life. I've been a skier since I was 6 years old. Never seen a coyote way up there in the snow. But to think that a coyote ran out and drug her and took her down in the snow, I think there would have been a lot of blood against that white snow. I think it would have showed up to the searchers. And to think that she wasn't found until June 8th, and she's found in the condition that's pretty prevalent in conditions we find people in this profile, very, very troublesome.
Now, here's another case. Anna Christian Waters from Half Moon Bay, California. You've investigated this case for a few times. Her mother even wrote a book about Anna's disappearance. You purchased the book and read it twice. You lost the book and your notes. These had never happened to you before. You purchased the book again, and after reading the book four times, you were convinced that Anna's story deserved to be included in your book. Tell us more about this story, and why was it so important to you?
Well, interestingly, it occurred about 35 miles north of where I grew up. It occurred in an area called Half Moon Bay, California, about 15 miles south of San Francisco, right on the Pacific coast, just a little south of an area called Devil's Slide. In this area, it's absolutely gorgeous. Back in January 1673 is when Anna disappeared. She was 5 years old. In those days, this was a pretty wild area, pretty rugged. Nowadays, it still can be pretty wild, but many, many high-technology execs from San Francisco and San Jose have built some huge homes because it's so gorgeous. There's a creek called Purissima Creek that runs down through this valley, and Anna and her mom lived in this house on the creek. Anna comes home from school, and she's playing in the backyard. And she comes in the house, and she tells her mom that she's going to stay in the backyard playing with her dog. She leaves her raincoat in the house. She goes back outside, and her mom says that after a short period of time, everything went quiet, very quiet. She went out into the backyard. Dog was there. Anna's gone. It had rained the day before, and the creek in the backyard was a little higher than normal. And initially, searchers thought that maybe she got washed away in the creek. Except when they brought canines in, the canines walked upstream from the house rather than downstream. And then they stopped. Interestingly, that day, there was a lot of weird things going on in this valley. There was a rooster that attacked a man that lived a very short distance from Anna. And the rooster had to be killed because it was attacking. Another person was walking their horse in some pasture and heard some strange noises in a bush, a real wild area just up from where Anna disappeared. There's a lot of strange things that specific day. San Mateo County sheriffs came in and they did a massive search, and it continued for days and days. And they put scuba divers in that worked the creek all the way from where Anna's house was down to the ocean, which was several miles. And they stated unequivocally that there was no way Anna's body could have gotten to the ocean because of the dams that were in place between her house and the ocean. And there was no way she was in the creek because they had cleared it several times. She's not in the ocean. She wasn't anywhere in the yards. And this went on, the search went on and off for months. Make a long story short, she was never found. And there's one other disappearance of a strange type that I wrote about in an earlier Missing 411 book, about 750 feet higher in elevation back in the mountains behind where Anna disappeared. A man disappeared in that area and was found in a gully in a very strange set of circumstances that I won't talk about. But it's strange to find these two stories in close proximity to each other. And Anna's mom did a great job writing about a book. And what you're going to find is that many parents of missing kids write about it, and it's a way for them to vent and heal. But she did a really good job of outlining kind of the family history and the elements that happened. But Anna, the bad weather, the animal stories, her being with her dog, a lot of things all compiled to meet the profile.
And then we had the case of Tomas Cabrera, Tecate, Mexico. Now, here's another case of a child. These children, I think all cases are important, but the children really baffle me. This is a three-year-old boy supposedly crossed 15 miles in the hot month of June. The boy was found with some scratches on his face and body and was slightly dehydrated. Look, I live in the desert. I got stranded once in 2002 mountain biking at noon in August. Stupid of me to do it at that time of the year, at about 115 degrees. I almost died. So I find it categorically absolutely impossible that a three-year-old can traverse 50 miles and still be alive. He must have been transported there.
Well, I think one thing that really puzzled searchers, and they even mentioned it, is they said, well, he must have found a hole in the fence as well, the border fence.
Yeah.
So I think they were puzzled by it, but they really never could explain how he made it that far. And to think about it, make it that far, number one, make it that far and be found, number two. It's like a needle in the haystack that he was found. So with a lot of these missing cases, especially children, they're found, which is, I find, utterly amazing on some of them. Some of them are found in areas that have been searched 100 times. But it's almost as though these kids are in an area where they're lucky enough to be found, and it seems like it's too lucky to happen almost as much as it does.
And then we have Steve Benson, another 3-year-old from Colorado, another story of a child who's found safe and sound, even though there was a dust storm of epic proportions. Tell us more.
Yeah, and that's what the newspaper talked about, maybe a 20, 30-year storm. And they called it a black blizzard because everything, it just picked up dust and dirt and started blowing, and you couldn't see your hand in front of your face. And he disappeared from outside his residence in the far southeastern corner of Colorado. And somehow or another, amongst all of this, with temperatures down at 30 degrees, he was gone all night. The following morning, somebody in a residence 6 miles away finds him. No shoes. And when they question the boy, he says, I fell asleep. That's all I remember. And they described him as in very good condition. And I'll stop there. And I think something that's become prevalent and important is the clothing and
the shoes.
Too many kids, too many adults are found without shoes. And I've talked about this very briefly, but we've rolled this around in our minds many times. What is it about shoes? Well, first of all, it protects our feet and it allows us to go into areas with a lot less pain than if you didn't have shoes. But I think one of the more important points to remember is it's probably the dirtiest piece of clothing that we have. And I don't know what else that could mean, but if you thought, you know, your pants, your shirt, not so dirty, but your shoes, they're pretty filthy. So other than us being able to walk long distances, it's that and a bacteria count on shoes that seem to be the two points that we keep going back to.
What about, and this again sounds far-fetched, but remember that I deal with paranormal subjects here. Shoes are usually made of rubber. They're not conductive when it comes to electricity. All these weather patterns that come along, you know, people that adults, their shoes are found next to their cars or campsites. Very curious, very peculiar, yes.
And that's a good point. And many of the cases that we wrote about this time had to do with people wearing sandals, leather sandals. And you got to remember that rubber is something fairly new, because back 60 years ago, most of the shoes were made of leather. And the people who disappeared in the woods back then were wearing leather boots and things. So I think that's something to consider, but I don't know if it's really critical.
And so far you've investigated, what, about 1,240 cases? Is that number still standing?
Yeah.
From all the cases, how many of the ones where the people are found alive have you been able to gather critical information about their stories, at least to be able to connect dots with others' testimonials?
Well, you have to go back into the record and read the reports, read the newspaper articles. And the vast majority of those times, people either don't remember or don't want to say. It's a very rare day where somebody comes out and is able to talk about what happened or talk about the days they were gone. It is something that does not happen very often at all.
And I wonder how many of those who say they don't remember, they say that because they don't want to tell.
That's a great question. It's a fine line between not remembering and not wanting to say and, you know, just having that blur in your mind space. Who knows?
Now, Bobby Bishop, I believe it's the last name, Colorado, a case with religion associated with military. That's fascinating. And even the Pope, John Paul II, walked the path that the child allegedly walked to when he disappeared. Can you tell us more about that one?
It's a case I know very, very well. One of the best cases. I've been to that location many times. I've walked that path many times, and it is confusing. There's a place called St. Malo, M-A-L-O. It's about 20 miles south of Estes Park, Colorado, and the Rocky Mountain National Park. St. Malo belongs to the Catholic Church, and in the 1950s and 60s, it was a summer retreat for families and kids. And they built a hotel on it, and it's still, the hotel burned down partially. And if you think about this history, in 58, Bobby disappears. Many years after that, the hotel burns down. And then in 93, Pope Paul shows up and walks the path. And then this last winter, they had a hellacious flood that completely changed the scope and the landscape of that river that Bobby was fishing on. So this area has gone through some real, real interesting historical events. But to put it in perspective, August 15th, 58, Bobby was 10 years old, and he was disabled. He could barely hear. He was wearing hearing aids. And there is another part of the profile that we talk about, high intellect and people with disabilities at the other end of that scale. He was fishing in a very small creek right behind the lodging area of this property. The counselor went back to get Bobby. It was about 6 o'clock at night, said it's dinner time. So at 6 o'clock at night, you're a 10-year-old boy and you hear it's dinner time. I think most 10-year-olds are going to be going straight to that cafeteria. Yeah. And the counselor thought Bobby was right behind him following him. So he gets back to the cafeteria, which is maybe a 5 or 10-minute walk. Bobby's not there. A couple of counselors go back, and they can't find him. And they start searching, and they mount a huge search that goes on for a couple of weeks. Amazingly, about a week after that, the director of the summer camp stated that they thought Bobby was in the woods hiding from them. Now, they didn't have any evidence that anyone that they could ever explain, but that's what they said. And the summer ends, winter starts, Bobby's never found. Now, Bobby's dad was a staff sergeant at a local Air Force base. And he made a statement about the second week into this search that he and his wife realized that they're not going to ever see their son again. And I wrote about it in the book, and it's the first time I ever heard a statement like that from parents at that 10-day to 2-week cycle. And I realize parents are under a lot of stress and things, but that was the first time I ever heard complete concession on the part of parents about not seeing their child. The next summer, three of the camp counselors just made it their goal to try to find out what happened to Bobby. So every minute they would go hiking up into the woods. Well, right behind the camp, Rocky Mountain National Park starts, and I'm talking right behind the camp. And as you hike up that trail that borders this small creek, you get up into an area where Mount Meeker starts. And Meeker is a 13,000-foot mountain, steep. And these counselors had searched this area dozens of times the year before with formal searches. And on this day, they followed the creek up into the site of Meeker up until they reached Timberline. And at Timberline, they found some scrap of clothing, a few fragmented bones, and a broken hearing aid. And that's all they found at Bobby Bishop. And troubling to say the least, because I've walked this area, and I can tell you there is no way in your wildest dreams that you could ever confuse the hike going up the side of Meeker for that 5-minute hike going downhill to the cafeteria. It's impossible. And it's one heck of a hike going up Meeker. And then June 14th, 1993, Pope Paul was visiting Denver. He ended up taking a helicopter from Denver into Rocky Mountain National Park and then took a car to St. Malo. And he walked that trail that Bobby Bishop walked. And there were pictures of the Pope on this trail and pictures and statements about the Pope being there. And then this last winter, when we had this huge floods in the area, it completely changed the scope of that valley from being a creek that was maybe 5 or 6 feet wide at its widest to being a roaring 200 feet wide at its widest.
Wow.
And just completely blew out the valley. It's hardly recognizable to what it was before.
Why do you think Pope John Paul was walking that path? Why? What was so significant? Was it related to the child or was it something else?
There's never any mention of Bobby in any article I could find regarding the Pope. There is a small little chapel called St. Mallow, and it is probably one of the most beautiful chapels you will ever see in your life, right next to the highway. And people get married there. And at the time he visited, I can imagine, I only made one visitation there prior to the winter blowout when it changed the landscape. And it was one of the most beautiful little creeks up this little valley that you can imagine. And I could see the Pope's handlers taking him up there because it is so gorgeous. But I could never find any correlation between Bobby and the Pope.
Now, how many?
I do find that it's pretty coincidental that both walked that
path. That's right. Now, how many times have you heard this? His or her body was found in an area that was searched before and should have been found. This seems to be the case with many, including the case of Jeff Christensen. Incredible story. Why is this case so important?
Well, first of all, at the back of the most recent book, there's a chart there that shows all of the cases where those statements were made. Just to allow the reader to absorb how many times this has happened. And there is no way that search and rescue personnel are so inefficient or you should point fingers at them as not doing their job. That is not the case. I don't think there's any way that these people are in these areas when searchers find them. Now, the Christensen case, Jeff was a stud guy. During the winter, he was a ski patrolman in Winter Park, Colorado. And during the summer months, he was a law enforcement ranger at Rocky Mountain National Park. Everybody liked the guy. Super smart, blonde hair, good looking, 31 years old. He went missing on July 29th, 2005. He would be your idea of a perfect park ranger, the exact guy you want to meet on the trail, law enforcement type, carried a gun, carried a radio. So he disappears. And at the time, the Park Service allowed their backcountry trail people to walk alone because he had a radio. Well, this is without some extraordinarily thorough work, we would never know that he disappeared on the 29th of July. The Park Service didn't figure out he was missing until well into the day on the 30th. Now, how could that happen? Because Christensen never made it back off the trail, and nobody was ensuring that all of the rangers checked in at the end of the night. They all went home. So here's Christensen out on the trail somewhere, apparently hurt. Nobody's even looking for him for 12, 14 hours. Now, they come in the next day and they see, well, his car's still here. His radio doesn't look like he was checked in. He must be missing. They try to raise him on the radio. They can't. Pretty soon, there's a massive search going on for him. And they figure out that after interviewing and finding people at campsites, they found out he was seen on an area called Mount Chiquita. And so they focused their search in that area. That was the last place they could place him. And they searched for 7 days. Well, during that search effort, there was a series of gunshots in the park. And this is something you don't hear in national parks, ever. Obviously, there's no hunting, and so nobody should be shooting a gun. And then they hear a couple of radios being activated, handheld radio being activated. Something else you don't hear very often, and there's no sounds on it other than
that. But if you shoot 3 times, isn't that a signal to be rescued?
Yeah, signal that you need help, exactly. So National Park Service puts up the big effort for 7 days and they stop. And I don't know if I think that's an adequate time or not, but I would think that I actually thought about this a lot, that this is one of their own. Why would they stop searching? So anyhow, they stop searching. The day after they stop searching, and within less than a mile of the location where he was last seen, in a boulder field below that peak, two people hiking find Jeff Christensen's body in an area that I don't believe even the National Park Service could have missed. And they find him dead with a bandage around his head, meaning that he hurt himself, he bandaged himself. So why wouldn't he have fired his gun for assistance, or why wouldn't he have activated his radio? Because he was alive for some period of time. A lot of questions here. So I file a Freedom of Information Act against the National Park Service for all the reports associated with this. And this got a critical incident review, which means a special team comes in and writes a lengthy report about what happened. Things I wanted to know is the condition of his gun. Were shots fired out of his gun? Did his radio still have battery power? Could it have activated? Etc. In the most amazing thing I've ever seen, even coming out of the National Park Service, I get a note saying, nope, you can't have this file until you pay $7,100. So I said, well, why is that? Because a couple years ago, I got a file on a ranger named Paul Fugate, who disappeared from Arizona. He's never been found. It's an active case. And the file was the size of a normal cardboard box. And that cost me $40. They told me that on this case, that the case has never been released to the public. No one's ever asked for it. A news reporter's never seen it. And so they need to review it. And it's going to take them 3 weeks by someone making $60 an hour. And I have to pay $7,100 for them to review it, making sure it's available and it should be released to the public. So understand, this isn't $7,100 to write the case. It's already done. They're saying I have to pay that just to see it.
Now, why is that? If the case is already done, why wouldn't they release? Is it? See, here's what I'm concluding in my mind. If two hikers found this person, that probably would embarrass the people at the government, saying if the two hikers found them, we should have found them. It's embarrassing. Let's put some roadblocks to David Paulides or anybody else who wants to come along and look into it.
That does seem to make some sense, Mel.
I can't see any other reason why. I mean, $7,200 for that, it's unbelievable. But we have to take our one and only intermission. We have more cases. When we come back, we'll discuss some cases from Florida. I used to live in Florida for many years. And to me, unless you're at the Everglades or some swamp, being flatland everywhere, I would think people would be much easier to find. But that doesn't seem to be the case. Dave, how can people buy the new book and all your other great books?
Well, visit the Can-Am Missing Project homepage at Can-Am, C-A-N as in Nancy, A-M as in Mary, canammissing.com. And it has their current cases that we're working. It has history on older cases and information on all the books.
You also have a map that you sent me that's pretty scary. Is that map available for sale too?
Yes, it is. And same page, and it shows a very small copy of the map where you can kind of get a feeling what you're getting.
And I have to say this, folks. This is the summer. This is the time when people step outside and go out to the wilderness. And we're not talking about this to spread fear at all. We just want you to be prepared and to know the truth so that when you go out there, you have a chance of survival.
That's correct. Absolutely.
So folks, don't go anywhere. I'm here with my special guest, David Paulides. This is Mel Fabregas, and you're listening to Veritas. Don't go anywhere. Thank you for listening to the first segment of this very important interview. To listen to the rest, go to veritasradio.com and subscribe. You will receive your login immediately. We'll take a short intermission, listen to some music, and we'll be right back. Enjoy. Greetings to everyone around the world, and a warm welcome to another edition of Veritas at veritasradio.com. I'm your host, Mel Fabregas, and I sincerely thank you for joining me once again. And if this is your first time, please make yourself at home. To listen to tonight's full interview, you know what to do. Simply go to our website, veritasradio.com, if you're not already there, and click on the subscribe button. Expand your horizons. Give yourself the gift of truth. And for pure organic sulfur crystals, MMS, or our futuristic mail-cased USB drives with all our seasons and bonus material, go to the Veritas store. And by popular demand, tonight's special guest is best-selling author and investigative journalist, former law enforcement officer, and senior executive in the technology sector, David Paulides. We'll discuss more mysterious disappearances in national parks and his new book, Missing 411, The Devil's in the Detail. And to learn more about David Paulides and purchase all his books, visit his website at canammissing.com, which is also linked at ours. And directly from Colorado, I'd like to welcome David Paulides. Hello, David, and welcome back to Veritas.
Hey, thanks, Mel. I appreciate it. It's always a good time spending some interesting time talking to you about the cases.
Absolutely. And usually I would introduce and talk about how you started in all of this, but we accomplished that already, and anyone can listen to our first interview on our website. I want to leverage these 2 hours as much as we can without being repetitive. And as you say in the new book, we're not going to delve deeply into details to prep the listeners for an understanding of the issue. To the listeners, please stop the audio right now and listen to the first interview if you have not done so before. That way you'll be able to have a clear understanding of what we'll be discussing tonight. But first, David, the new book about the title, The Devil's in the Detail. Why the title?
Well, first of all, detail is an important part when you're doing research, and there's that old saying, the devil is in the detail, and it's true. And the stories are nice, and the dates are nice, but really you need to get down into the nitty-gritty, get down into the dirt, and start really figuring out what is the commonality between each of these. The other part of that is that in earlier books, there have been an abnormal amount of people that have disappeared in areas where the name Devil appears in the geographical location. Devil's Lookout, Devil's Mountain, Devil Lakes. It just seems like an abnormal amount and too many coincidences to just ignore it.
Absolutely. And, you know, I wonder, how many times have you been denied information? We see this all the time in your cases. How many times have you been denied information about a certain case and you're told you'll never get information about this case? What is the reason they give you, if any, and have you appealed or sought a judicial review after, you know, requesting a FOIA request?
Well, the outright and the straight up denial has happened just once, and that was on the Stacey Ayres case out of Yosemite. And that was verbally told to me on the phone with a National Park Service special agent. And no, they never gave a specific reason why I would get it, why I wouldn't get it, other than I just wasn't going to get it. And their other denials are more contrived, and either they make the dollar amount to get the report so exorbitant that nobody could afford it, and say $1.4 million for a list of missing people from their entire system, or more recently, $7,100 for them to review a file on a case that where Ranger disappeared. So they put roadblocks in front of you, and I suppose you could call that their way of denying it.
Do you think that this happens just to you because your name is probably very public out there?
You know, I'd like to say I hope not, but I have a gut feeling that this is more organized than we may think. And there have been other people, in fact, other National Park Service rangers that have FOIA'd the National Park Service over details and have run into roadblocks before as well. So to say that this is a first for the National Park Service, I would definitely say not. It seems that they have a long history of not being as transparent as they would like the public to think. And in reality, their interpretation of the Freedom of Information Act is quite different than many other departments in our government.
And the word missing and presumed dead, this is something that the Department of Interior uses a lot. How can people find those who are lost if they're removed or purged from a database on a case that should not be purged?
Well, that seems to be a pretty convenient way to wash your hands of many missing persons cases and sweep it away and say, well, the purser's offices in Oregon and Washington that are filled with unknown bones that they've found in the woods, and they can't match them to anybody's. So therein lies the problem with the National Park Service and the Department of the Interior's policy. And like I said, it may be an absolutely contrived and organized policy in order to keep the numbers down so people truly don't know how many people are missing.
You know, I think we discussed this in our last interview, but I'm not a trained investigator like you are, but logic tells me that they're just sweeping the names under the rug to avoid panic. Imagine if you go to XYZ Park and find out there are hundreds of people missing. Would you go in there? They just don't want the public to be aware of the dangers that exist in the woods, as they may, you know, it can affect tourism and how many millions of dollars can be lost.
Well, it could be mind-boggling.
So do you think this is the main reason why they want to keep this under the rug, to avoid people from saying, you know, family, let's don't go to this park this year because this may happen to us?
I've already had people write to me and tell me that I've put them on notice, and you know the books have made them more aware of these issues. But the reality of it is that I don't discourage anybody from going to our parks. I tell them to go to the parks and carry a transponder, keep your children inside at all times, don't get separated, and don't hike alone. And I think under those parameters, you're generally going to be fairly safe. But it does seem that there's an abnormal amount of missing people in national parks.
You know, reading your books, I find so many similarities between the cases. And I find it interesting that law enforcement, it's not that they're not doing a good job, but they haven't broken the quote-unquote code of these cases, since there's a repetitive nature of the elements that exist on these disappearances. Do you find that peculiar?
Well, you got to remember, Mel, that law enforcement works in a confined area. Say you have a county sheriff. Well, he's responsible for his county. And let's say you have a state police officer. Well, they're responsible for their state. But there's nobody really that's looking at the gravity of the problem when you look at, say, the United States and Canada, and then you start to look at North America as a whole, and then you start to put together the cases jurisdiction by jurisdiction. Unfortunately, missing people is the bastard child of law enforcement. And I've never known an investigator that's wanted to work missing persons cases. And the reason being is that missing people, many of them disappear on their own. They don't want to be around, and there's no crime to that. But when you spend, say, 100 hours tracking down a missing person, and then you find them, and it's just somebody who wants, and then you have people that, say, a teenager that just runs away because he doesn't want to be, or she doesn't want to be with her parents. Well, that's still a missing person and somebody you got to track down. So you get these kind of cases that, to some law enforcement people, may seem meaningless and a waste of time. But then you run into an issue like this, or say a string of homicides on the Highway of Tears where there's hundreds of missing people, missing women up in the Canada and British Columbia area. You start to get into something like that, and it starts to get much more interesting quickly. So it's a national or continent issue here, and then it's an issue in other countries. And then you start to think of it, and just like you said, once you read the books and you start to understand the underlying current to the issue and the parallel issues that exist in amongst the different cases, you start to find out that, well, this is a much more intriguing thing than we began with. And I'm not taking credit and luck than anything else, but I wouldn't expect law enforcement to be able to understand this problem and figure it out. And this was somebody who had a team of people with an exorbitant amount of time to really dig deep. And there just aren't those people out there working missing people doing that.
Dave, is the same criterion used, for example, somebody at home doesn't see a relative, you know, get back home tonight. Police usually tells you have to wait 24 hours before you can report the person missing. Is that the same criterion used when somebody gets lost in a national park, or is it a different set of criteria used?
You know, the criteria for reporting missing people has changed a lot over the years. Before, it used to be 24 hours. Now it's changed, and most of the time, law enforcement jumps on it right away. When somebody goes missing in the woods, it's usually a critical issue very, very fast because of weather conditions, because maybe they're hurt, maybe they're lost, maybe they need. It could be a lot different than somebody who's missing in an urban environment, but then again, both cases could need attention immediately. So I don't think when somebody's reported missing, especially a very young person in an urban environment, it's not delayed, it's handled, it's worked on right away. Just like anybody who goes missing in the woods, there's a reaction to it and people are on it quickly.
And I know you don't like to give your opinion and I won't ask for your opinion, but after so many years of investigating, do you think that the field of suspects is narrowing?
Well, I've had a lot of response to the new book that's out, and I think the surprising aspect, since presumed dead, they're not really missing anymore, and that's their way to permanently get rid of the case. They won't be found on any databases. They won't be classified as missing people. And if I did come up with the $1.4 million for the list of missing people in the National Park Service, I have no doubt that those cases would not appear because they're no longer missing. They're under this new classification, missing presumed dead. And with that, it's a very, very convenient way to keep the numbers down, keep the public unaware of how many people are missing. And it's unfortunate because when I first found it, I couldn't believe it existed.
Heaven forbid you or I or anyone listening loses a loved one. How do you think they'll feel if their loved one is considered presumed dead without any proof? Actually, I wouldn't have a problem as long as the name is on the list so we can continue searching.
Well, I think anybody would be astounded that the National Park Service would do something like that and that it may be a policy in the Department of the Interior that may be more widespread than we understand. And there's a very, very good chance that some of the cases that I've found just through digging through newspaper archives, et cetera, may never have been found and may never be understood if we haven't brought them out to light. And with that, I'll transcend to something else, Mel. It's something called NAMIS. And NAMIS is an organization that was founded within the National Institute of Justice, and it was just for this type of thing. And we were contacted by a NAMIS researcher maybe a year ago. And she had read one of the books, and she said, Dave, I think you have cases that need to go on the NAMIS website. And what NAMIS is it's a website specifically used by law enforcement, coroners, forensic people that come up with bones in the woods, just like they would find in the national parks where there's no longer any reports, and they can match reports to the bones and get closure for a family. Turns out that there's, I think, 8 or 10 cases now that NAMIS has from us that they never had before because we were able to get the original police reports and things to substantiate the case, put it on NAMIS's website, and now if those bodies are ever found, they may be able to link the DNA between the two individuals or the case report and the individual. Without NAMIS, there probably wouldn't be any way to do it other than mere guesswork.
No, if the National Park Service classifies the missing as missing and presumed dead, then what happens when the coroner and medical examiners receive recovered remains? Can they place the bones with the body?
Well, when they explain that there's rooms in coroner,
we came along, they must know how and why a location was named. Do you know?
Well, and that's a great question, but you got to remember that these places, received their geographical names sometimes 150, 200 years ago. And even you talk to the elders or people who have lived in areas a long time, It baffles them sometimes how it got its name. I was just in an area the other day that had an unusual name, and we were asking some people how they got it, and nobody knew. So I think that's a hard thing to get answers to.
But interesting that the name Devil just comes out. Devil's Vomit. There's one that we're going to discuss later. I believe it was in Idaho. But I don't follow Bigfoot or Sasquatch that much, the topic, or even the stories of large flying animals. But I'm just going to say animals for a moment. Some call them flying dinosaurs, flying reptiles, fill in the blanks. And the reason why I bring this up is because of the many children who disappear without leaving any trail or scent behind and then reappear high in a mountain when it would have probably impossible for the child to make the trek. Keeping an open mind here, Dave, the child being grabbed by a flying animal, would not that be far-fetched after all, would it?
Well, personally, I've never seen that, and I don't hear many law enforcement people in the park system talking about that. And if you look at the kids that have disappeared, some of them are pretty big, and I don't even know if there's any birds of prey out there large enough to carry some of these 3 and 4 year olds away that weigh, 40, 50, 60 pounds, way more than the bird. So I don't know if that's real. And then the point of them disappearing, as the parents say, almost in their presence, or I turned around on, if that was happening, you would think that the child would scream and yell at the minimum. At the maximum, you would think that the parents may hear something behind them, a scuffle or some sound or the bird or the child's making. So, this has been brought up before. I just have a difficult time understanding how I could make that work.
And believe me, conventional wisdom says it's impossible. But at the same time, no scent. All of a sudden, the child is, a few thousand feet above. And it's impossible for the child to make it up all the way up there, without dying, and it's there. So I'm just trying to step outside the box. And stepping outside the box after hundreds of years of these cases, and you have a lot of them, and I commend you for not speculating or coming to conclusions. I think that's a great thing that you have done so far. But with all these years of these cases, isn't it time to go out of our comfort zone to look for answers?
And I think we're one of those groups that is doing exactly that. We entertain all ideas. I've read more books on a variety of topics than most people would ever read in their lives. And everyone has maybe a fringe topic that they like to read about, but throw that in the garbage and then start reading about things you really aren't interested in to keep that open mind. And that's what we've done. And I don't think in this latest book that delving into a disappearance off the ocean and then a disappearance in the skies would happen unless we had kept that open mind. And as long as that profile stays consistent, I think you're going to continue to see us with that open mind and try to understand how far this parameter really goes that until we could break this code and figure it out. But no, I'm never one to shut down somebody and say, I don't think this is possible. Unless, like you just said, common logic just doesn't come into it. Mm-hmm. But you have to keep it.
Yeah, I'm losing you there. Can you hear me?
Oop. I can hear you fine.
Okay, good. All right. Now, the best way for me to understand the nature of all of this and for the listeners is discussing some of the cases. So here's a case. Let's start with the new book. This woman and her husband are skiing. The husband makes it to the bottom, and the wife never does. Tell us more.
It happened in February 19th, 1999, Bear Valley, California, 47-year-old physician.
Catherine Wong, Dr. Catherine Wong, that's right.
And she was from Milpitas, California. And this goes back, this hits on several notes for us. First of all, this is on that high intellectual end of the intellectual scale. She's a smart, smart lady. Took a day off of work to go skiing with her husband. And it was the last ski run, and they go to the top of the chair, and she goes, "Hey, I'm going to go this way. You go that way. I'll meet you at the bottom." Okay. He gets to the bottom. She doesn't show up. He waits. Searchers show up. Now, you got to understand, when you search for somebody in the snow, it's a lot different than searching for them on dry, hard dirt. Because off of the ski run, there's only so many paths you can take, and each one of those paths, as a searcher, it's pretty easy to follow. There aren't a lot of places to go that you won't be followed. So you can imagine that after a day or two, you've exhausted every track that's run off that slope that she went down. And there was a big effort, huge effort. And then eventually the weather turned and searchers had to leave. And it wasn't until June of 99, 4 months later, after several other searches, that they finally found bone fragments and some scattered and some pieces of her personal attire. And that's how they found her. Now, let's think about this. So if she left that ski run, you should be able to follow that. Now, you fly over that with FLIR, forward-looking infrared radar that senses heat. You should be able to find her. You bring in canines, you should be able to find her. Now, an interesting note is the sheriff said, well, maybe she was attacked by a bear or a coyote. Okay, well, it's February, there's 20 feet of snow. I don't think bears are running around. They're hibernating.
That's right.
Yeah. And then coyotes, if she was attacked, I think searchers would have found her.
See, this is immoral to even think about it, in my opinion, but you have to look at the other side. If they're protecting their turf, bringing this information out, even though there's people who are missing, would be devastating to them. So I'm trying to just not play devil's advocate here.
I think both ways, Mel, there is a lack of integrity there. Either way you look at it, it is. And I think that, as we've talked about before, where we've offered to buy them clipboards and a laptop and to kind of force their hand, because in the past they said that they didn't have the money to do this and they didn't have the money for a big computer system. Trust me, there is no need for all of this. Clipboards in every office of the national parks. And once a month, when they turn in their monthly reports, which they are required to do, that have any big issues in the parks reported to headquarters, you just send in a 5-line notation about where the person went missing off the clipboard, send it into National Parks headquarters, and somebody with a $500 laptop could keep track easily of every missing, the circumstances, blah, blah, blah. So when they say that they don't have the money to do it, you know that that goes back to a lack of integrity. If they wanted to keep track of it, anybody could keep track of this. And as I've stated before, we have had a female from Microsoft that saw what was happening. She offered to help us. She jumped in. And Sue has worked diligently to put together an extensive database that we will gladly share with the National Park Service that we use to track and identify specific elements in these missing people. Now, I know I'm not keeping an open mind that they're going to contact us because, as you said, I think this is an organized method to control the information and keep the lid on this issue.
I'll even up the ante for a moment. I know you want to buy them the clipboards. I'll buy them a computer. I'll even sponsor one full-time person for that entire year that could be sitting in a cubicle in Washington gathering this information. Do you think they would accept that offer?
Maybe they would from you, but I doubt from me.
That's right. That's right. I find it interesting, Dave, how the disappearances don't occur immediately after at the same location, but something could happen, say, at the Grand Canyon, and then, you know, 2 days later in Yosemite. It doesn't happen in the same location. Have you found that commonality as well?
Well, in fact, we talk about it in the books that there's this a hopscotch effect. One on the East Coast, one on the West Coast, one in the North, one in the South. And it's just enough where if you looked at it, you would say it's almost too organized of a dispersal across the U.S. because you would think that every once in a while, three or four in a row would hit in one area, but it never happens that way. It would be difficult to identify.
And to me, you know, I'm speculating here. I know you don't like to speculate, but this almost seems as if it's being coordinated from a centralized location, because you don't want to have two people disappear one after the other, because that then the whole country will descend upon that area and bring more suspicion.
Correct. So you had a national park and you had two or three people disappear over a 10 or 15 year period. That's probably not going to raise too much suspicion because there's a rotation of rangers that go through the national parks. Most of them spend between 5 or 10 years in a park, and then they move on. And the same is for the life of a law enforcement officer, say, in a county. Say they spend 20, 25 years and they retire. Well, if you keep that spread out a lot, it's not the same place in the county. It's every, say, 7 to 15 years somebody disappears. It's not going to be that big of a deal. And then you spread it out in North America, it even becomes less apparent that there's this taking or missing people.
You know, another interesting aspect after reading your books, and even the latest, is that the cases have very similar circumstances surrounding them. So if there's anyone out there saying, oh, David, you're just making these stories up, then you wouldn't be doing such a good job. Many similarities between the cases. What do you say about that? So similar.
Well, I think that's the part that makes this so interesting. And it's for anyone who actually reads the books, you're going to quickly understand that there's many elements that are similar. In fact, some of the cases almost look like cookie cutters of each other. And it can be young people, middle-aged people, older people, high intellect, very low intellect, very few people in the middle, like me, and it's disturbing.
And I know guns are now allowed in national parks, but the volume of people carrying guns also, correct me if I'm wrong, wouldn't that depend on the state or city around the park? Have you found a correlation between location where guns are predominant versus those that are not? In other words, more disappearances in places where guns are not that prevalent.
You know, I can't say that there's a correlation between where guns are, say, more frequently allowed than not. In California, it's probably one of the tightest gun-controlled states, and some states in the eastern U.S. And if you look at the numbers, I mean, in Yosemite, the biggest cluster of missing people in North America, it's huge. But then again, you go to Colorado, where the gun laws are fairly liberal and you can carry a gun almost everywhere, still the numbers are huge. So the only thing I've publicly stated that I can say categorically is true is that we don't know anybody who's ever disappeared carrying a gun and a personal locator transponder. We've known them to go missing carrying a gun. I've known people to go missing carrying a transponder. Carrying both, I don't know.
Have you ever spoken to Native Americans about the names of some of these locations? I mean, the title, Devil, that these people have been there before. Greetings to everyone around the world, and a warm welcome to another edition of Veritas at VeritasRadio.com. I'm your host, Mel Fabregas, and I sincerely thank you for joining me once again. And if this is your first time, please make yourself at home. To listen to tonight's full interview, you know what to do. Simply go to our website, VeritasRadio.com, if you're not already there, and click on the subscribe button. Expand your horizons. Give yourself the gift of truth. And for pure organic sulfur crystals, MMS, or our futuristic metal-cased USB drives with all our seasons and bonus material, go to the Veritas store. And by popular demand, tonight's special guest is best-selling author and investigative journalist, former law enforcement officer and senior executive in the technology sector, David Paulides. We'll discuss more mysterious disappearances in national parks and his new book, Missing 411, The Devil's in the Detail. And to learn more about David Paulides and purchase all his books, visit his website at canammissing.com, which is also linked at ours. And directly from Colorado, I'd like to welcome David Paulides. Hello, David, and welcome back to Veritas.
Hey, thanks, Mel. I appreciate it. It's always a good time spending some interesting time talking to you about the cases.
Absolutely. And usually I would introduce and talk about how you started in all of this, but we accomplished that already, and anyone can listen to our first interview on our website. I want to leverage these 2 hours as much as we can without being repetitive. And as you say in the new book, we're not going to delve deeply into details to prep the listeners for an understanding of the issue. To the listeners, please stop the audio right now and listen to the first interview if you have not done so before. That way you'll be able to have a clear understanding of what we'll be discussing tonight. But first, David, the new book about the title, The Devil's in the Detail. Why the title?
Well, first of all, detail is an important part when you're doing research. And there's that old saying, the devil is in the detail, and it's true. And the stories are nice, and the dates are nice, but really you need to get down into the nitty-gritty, get down into the dirt, and start really figuring out what is the commonality between each of these. The other part of that is that in earlier books, there have been an abnormal amount of people that have disappeared in areas where the name Devil appears in the geographical location. Devil's Lookout, Devil's Mountain, Devil Lakes. It just seems like an abnormal amount and too many coincidences to just ignore it.
Absolutely. And, you know, I wonder, how many times have you been denied information? We see this all the time in your cases. How many times have you been denied information about a certain case and you're told you'll never get information about this case? What is the reason they give you, if any? And have you appealed or sought a judicial review after, you know, requesting a FOIA request?
Well, the outright and the straight up denial has happened just once. And that was on the Stacey Ayres case out of Yosemite. And that was verbally told to me on the phone with a National Park Service special agent. And no, they never gave a specific reason why I would get it, why I wouldn't get it, other than I just wasn't going to get it. And their other denials are more contrived, and either they make the dollar amount to get the report so exorbitant that nobody could afford it, say $1.4 million for a list of missing people from their entire system, or more recently, $7,100 for them to review a file on a case that where Ranger disappeared. So they put roadblocks in front of you, and I suppose you could call that their way of denying it.
Do you think that this happens just to you because your name is probably very public out there?
You know, I'd like to say I hope not, but I have a gut feeling that this is more organized than we may think. And there have been other people, in fact, other National Park Service rangers that have FOIA'd the National Park Service over details and have run into roadblocks before as well. So to say that this is a first for the National Park Service, I would definitely say not. It seems that they have a long history of not being as transparent as they would like the public to think. And in reality, their interpretation of the Freedom of Information Act is quite different than many other departments in our government.
And the word missing and presumed dead, this is something that the Department of Interior uses a lot. How can people find those who are lost if they're removed or purged from a database on a case that should not be purged?
Well, that seems to be a pretty convenient way to wash your hands of many missing persons cases and sweep it away and say, well, the person's presumed dead. They're not really missing anymore. And that's their way to permanently get rid of the case. They won't be found on any databases. They won't be classified as missing people. And if I did come up with the 1.4 million for the list of missing people in the National Park Service, I have no doubt that those cases would not appear because they're no longer missing. They're under this new classification, missing presumed dead. And with that, it's a very, very convenient way to keep the numbers down, keep the public unaware of how many people are missing. And it's unfortunate because when I first found it, I couldn't believe it existed.
Heaven forbid you or I or anyone listening loses a loved one. How do you think they'll feel if their loved one is considered presumed dead without any proof at the same criterion used when somebody gets lost in a national park? Or is it a different set of criteria used?
You know, the criteria for reporting missing people has changed a lot over the years. Before, it used to be 24 hours. Now it's changed, and most of the time, law enforcement jumps on it right away. When somebody goes missing in the woods, it's usually a critical issue very, very fast because of weather conditions, because maybe they're hurt, maybe they're lost, maybe they need... It could be a lot different than somebody who's missing in an urban environment, but then again, both cases could need attention immediately. So I don't think when somebody's reported missing, especially a very young person in an urban environment, it's not delayed, it's handled, it's worked on right away. Just like anybody who goes missing in the woods, there's a reaction to it and people are on it quickly.
And I know you don't like to give your opinion and I won't ask for your opinion, but after so many years of investigating, do you think that the field of suspects is narrowing?
Well, I've had a lot of response to the new book that's out, and I think the surprising aspect that people find is that there's more parameters that are added in this new book than there were in other books. There's a group of people who went missing on the ocean off the coast of Florida. There's a parallel between people we've reported missing and missing airplanes. Somebody in Finland did a phenomenal amount of work and gave us a report indicating that there were 125 planes in 68 years that have disappeared in the Bermuda Triangle. Yeah. And four of those incidents match dates of people who have disappeared that we've written about. And if you look at those statistics, the statistical probability that those would match at four different levels is pretty phenomenal.
What do you think the correlation is between these planes disappearing and the people disappearing? Is there a weather phenomenon taking place at the same time?
Yes, there is. And that's part of that profile. But even taking it one step further, we revealed in this book that there's also five aircraft that have crashed while looking for people missing that we've profiled. So now you have four planes missing in the Bermuda Triangle that match the dates of four people who have crashed while looking for missing people. So you could almost say there's some kind of unusual aerial phenomena in conjunction with the missing people, in conjunction with the weather phenomena we've identified with the missing people. So aerial, weather, planes, I don't know what to say about it, but there seems to be a current of commonality there.
I remember growing up in the 70s, one of the corners of the Bermuda Triangle in the Caribbean, and this is what started me in the paranormal road, if you will, was the fact that almost on a monthly basis, I would see the newspaper of, you know, planes or ships, you know, getting lost, almost like the latest Malaysian airline, you know, flight. I think that's a different story. But we don't see that anymore. Yet we continue seeing missing people all over the world, even from the 1800s, sharing the same way in which they were lost. Do you still see the same patterns from 100 or 200 years ago still happening today?
You know, it hasn't changed. It's consistent with that profile, going all the way back to a case in 1756 that we identified. So the real question comes back is, if there was a way to go back into time 500 years ago, was it happening then at the same consistency with the same profile? Maybe. But the real interesting part to us is that that profile has stayed pretty consistent amongst the four books without having to really tweak it. It's the same, like you identified earlier, there is that commonality amongst these cases that is troublesome.
When you have spoken to the National Park Service and the Department of Interior about their method of dealing with missing people, how in good conscience could they not track missing people? What have they told you when you asked that question?
So I've only talked to the head of the law enforcement group from the National Park Service one time about the Stacey Harris case and why they wouldn't supply it. And then we got into a more deep discussion about why I wanted the information and why I wanted to know so much about missing people inside their system. So they really don't and won't talk too much. I suppose the most revealing thing happened when I was at a national park this last summer with a friend, and we happened to stumble into a informal meeting amongst four older gentlemen in a satellite office of a national park, and I kind of stood there listening to what they were saying, and I knew these guys knew a lot about what was happening. So one of the gentlemen got out and walked to the parking lot, and I followed him out, and I introduced myself, and I said I was a retired law enforcement man, and I said, I could tell you were somehow related to law enforcement here. And he said, yes, I'm a retired special agent from the National Park Service. And I thought, bingo, this is exactly what I want to talk to right here. We ended up talking for a long time. And I wanted to understand why the Park Service doesn't track missing people, because it's not only politically incorrect, it's incorrect at every law enforcement level you can imagine. And he said, quoting him, Dave, it's a lack of integrity. And he says, the Park Service does things that don't make any sense, that doesn't have a lot of integrity to it. Everybody else knows they should be doing it, but they won't. And we had a discussion about many things that day. And it was confusing, to say the least, disturbing, to say the most.
Do you really lend credence to the lack of integrity excuse, or is there more an underlying current that silence that it's implied to really don't go there, because your job is on the line, and the job of so many people in towns and businesses, local economies could just be devastated if this information came out. I can see, actually, I wouldn't have a problem as long as the name is on the list so we can continue searching.
Well, I think anybody would be astounded that the National Park Service would do something like that, and that it may be a policy in the Department of the Interior that may be more widespread than we understand. And there's a very, very good chance that some of the cases that I've found, just through digging through newspaper archives, et cetera, may never have been found and may never be understood if we haven't brought them out to light. And with that, I'll transcend to something else, Mel. It's something called NAMIS. And NAMIS is an organization that was founded within the National Institute of Justice, and it was just for this type of thing. And we were contacted by a NAMIS researcher maybe a year ago, and she had read one of the books, and she said, Dave, I think you have cases that need to go on the NAMIS website. And what NAMIS is it's a website specifically used by law enforcement, coroners, forensic people that come up with bones in the woods, just like they would find in the national parks where there's no longer any reports, and they can match reports to the bones and get closure for a family. Turns out that there's, I think, 8 or 10 cases now that NAMIS has from us that they never had before, because we were able to get the original police reports and things to substantiate the case, put it on NAMIS's website, and now if those bodies are ever found, they may be able to link the DNA between the two individuals, or the case report and the individual. Without NAMIS, there probably wouldn't be any way to do it other than mere guesswork.
No, if the National Park Service classifies the missing as missing and presumed dead, then what happens when the coroner and medical examiners receive recovered remains? Can they place the bones with the body?
Well, when they explained that there's rooms in coroner's offices in Oregon and Washington that are filled with unknown bones that they've found in the woods, and they can't match them to any bodies. So therein lies the problem, with the National Park Service and the Department of the Interior's policy. And like I said, it may be an absolutely contrived and organized policy in order to keep the numbers down so people truly don't know how many people are missing.
And I think we discussed this in our last interview, but I'm not a trained investigator like you are, but logic tells me that they're just sweeping the names under the rug to avoid panic. Imagine if you go to XYZ Park and find out there are hundreds of people missing. Would you go in there? They just don't want the public to be aware of the dangers that exist in the woods, as they may, you know, it can affect tourism and how many millions of dollars can be lost.
Well, it could be mind-boggling.
So do you think this is the main reason why they want to keep this under the rug, to avoid people from saying, you know, family, let's don't go to this park this year because this may happen to us?
Well, I've already had people write to me and tell me that I've put them on notice, and, you know, the books have made them more aware of these issues. But the reality of it is that I don't discourage anybody from going to our parks. I tell them to go to the parks and carry a transponder, keep your children inside at all times, don't get separated, and don't hike alone. And I think under those parameters, you're generally going to be fairly safe. But it does seem that there's an abnormal amount of missing people in national parks.
You know, reading your books, I find so many similarities between the cases. And I find it interesting that law enforcement, it's not that they're not doing a good job, but they haven't broken the quote-unquote code of these cases, since there's a repetitive nature of the elements that exist on these disappearances. Do you find that peculiar?
Well, you got to remember, Mel, that law enforcement works in a confined area. Say you have a county sheriff. Well, he's responsible for his county. And let's say you have a state police officer. Well, they're responsible for their state. But there's nobody really that's looking at the gravity of the problem when you look at, say, the United States and Canada, and then you start to look at North America as a whole, and then you start to put together the cases jurisdiction by jurisdiction. Unfortunately, missing people is the bastard child of law enforcement. And I've never known an investigator that's wanted to work missing persons cases. And the reason being is that missing people, many of them disappear on their own. They don't want to be around, and there's no crime to that. But when you spend, say, 100 hours tracking down a missing person, and then you find them, and it's just somebody you want, and then you have people that, say, a teenager that just runs away because he doesn't want to be, or she doesn't want to be with her parents. Well, that's still a missing person and somebody you got to track down. So you get these kind of cases that to some law enforcement people may seem meaningless and a waste of time. But then you run into an issue like this, or say a string of homicides on the Highway of Tears where there's hundreds of missing people, missing women, up in the Canada and British Columbia area, you start to get into something like that, and it starts to get much more interesting quickly. So it's a national or continent issue here, and then it's an issue in other countries. And then you start to think of it, and just like you said, once you read the books and you start to understand the underlying current to the issue and the parallel issues that exist in and amongst the different cases, you start to find out that, well, this is a much more intriguing thing than we began with. And I'm not taking luck than anything else, but I wouldn't expect law enforcement to be able to understand this problem and figure it out. And this was somebody who had a team of people with an exorbitant amount of time to really dig deep. And there just aren't those people out there working missing people doing that.
Dave, is the same criterion used, for example, somebody at home doesn't see a relative, you know, get back home tonight? Police usually tells you have to wait 24 hours before you can report the person missing. Is that